yourself.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome. Welcome to worship in the well. I am so glad that of all the places you could have been this morning, you made your way here. And it makes me happy, but most importantly, it delights our Father in heaven, our God, to be joined in this way, to be in communion together through the Holy Spirit with God in worship, that we can bring all of who we are into this place and share our heart with God and one another is the most amazing thing that we could do with our time. So welcome. I'm Reverend Ann Kovan. I'm your associate pastor here at Central United Methodist Church. Our mission here at Central is to follow Jesus and love God and love our neighbors. Whether you are worshiping with us here in this place, in this time, or worshiping with us online, welcome. Welcome. It's a joy and delight to be here with you today. If you're a first-time visitor with us today, a special welcome to you. There will be a point in the service where you'll have an opportunity to go visit our greeter table at the back of the room, and we have a gift for you. And the gift is just to let you know that God anticipated you being here this morning and that you are loved. So I hope that you will do that at that point in the service. On your way in, I hope you picked up an order of worship. It guides us through our service. Also, pretty much everything that you need is also going to be on the screen behind me. Also, we have our January Under the Dome newsletters available. If you receive our emails, you should have gotten an email with a digital version. It's also on our website. There's so much going on. We have a ton of new Bible studies and groups that are starting. We do ask that you register for those. It really helps us know how many materials and curriculum to order so that we're being efficient and good stewards. You can go to our website and just click on ministries, and in that drop down, select adult Bible studies. It will take you to the list of everything that we have coming up, and it actually has a link there that you can register for those Bible studies. When you came in, also on the greeters tables are a few Bibles. The Bibles are there for you to take, to give to somebody who doesn't have one. There's really no better gift that you could give somebody than a Bible. So if you know somebody who needs a Bible, doesn't have one, please, please, those are there for you to take and give to somebody else. I want to highlight a few things that are going on in the life of the church. We have begun our Vienna sausage drive to support Help for Kids. They take thousands and thousands of Vienna sausage cans each week. About 4,500 Vienna sausage cans every week that go in food bags to children who suffer from food insecurity. So we have baskets in here and one in the commons area. So when you're out doing your grocery shopping, just buy some Vienna sausages and bring them here and donate them. We'll be collecting them all month. All right, and I want to ask, if you serve on the well design team, would you just stand up? Thank you, thank you, thank you. You may be seated. The reason I'm pointing out this team is that this service is not like the service in the sanctuary. This is not a dedicated sanctuary or space, that it is a multi-purpose room that is used throughout the week. This team comes in on Fridays. Sometimes they're forced to come in on Saturdays or even Sunday mornings to set this room up, and it takes a lot of work, and so many of you help that aren't on the design team, but you help us set up and you help us break down, and I just want to say thank you for that work. And Susan Powers isn't here today. She has been the design team chairperson for 3 years and has carried a lot of the load of making this service happen. So she has resigned from her. Her term came up, and Till Morrissey is going to take her place as chair. So we appreciate your support, and I appreciate that when you can find somebody and just tell them thank you. If you see Susan, tell her thank you for her good work. And when you see Till, give her encouragement for all the work that she now has before her. All right, our ministry spotlight for this month is our youth ministry. And there's so much to share about that. And so we actually have a youth here today, and I'm going to let him speak to you about his experience through youth ministry.
Just about every Sunday. And this past December, me and a few friends worked on a project called Santa Hatchie. It's where we basically stay in the church for a week and help build houses and repair houses for people that can't necessarily afford to get them repaired. And during Santa Hatchie, we have this thing called a symbol ceremony. It's basically where you just find a symbol while you're working on a site, and you explain what it means during the ceremony and what that meaning has for you. And so this year, I strangely picked a lawnmower because at the house I worked at, there were several non-working lawnmowers, four, I believe. And one, we finally got to work, and I was very proud of being able to fix that small problem for her. And Santa Hatchie helps remind me that we are all called to the hands and feet of Jesus. Moving forward, I plan to take the lessons that I learned during Santa Hatchie to better serve others in my community and at school.
Thank you, Henry. If we could, let's all stand as we sing our creed this morning.
I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in life eternal, I believe in the virgin birth, I believe in the saints' communion, and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. I believe in the life ever after. In Jesus' name, amen.
Y'all couldn't hear him, but Warren just took a big breath. And it's because, you know, he was out last week, and I told him, I said, well, starting in 2024, we're going to have a new rule with the band. If you're out 1 week, you got to sing a solo the next week. So, but no.
I didn't know this.
Warren didn't know that before he was out. But, you know, I'm so thankful. You know, it's a new year and everything kicking off. And I'm so thankful for these four people up here with me that I get the opportunity to do this with every week. And, you know, we've got some changes that will be happening, good changes. That'll still be happening as we progress in 2024, and y'all are slowly see new things added up here, some things moved around, but you know, just be in prayer for us as we do what we feel that God is leading us to do up here on stage.
I
about this baby boy who's come to earth to give us joy. And I just wanna sing this song to you. It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, and the major lift. With every breath I'm singing, alleluia, 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 alleluia. A couple came to Bethlehem, expecting child, they searched the inn to find a place, for you were coming soon. There was no room for them to stay, in a manger filled with hay. God's only son was born, oh hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Shepherds left their flocks by night to see the baby wrapped in light. A host of angels led them all to you. It was just as the angels said, you'll find him in a manger bed. Emmanuel and Savior, alleluia, 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 alleluia. The stars shone bright up in the east, to Bethlehem the wise men three came many miles and journeyed long for you. And to the place at which you were, their frankincense and gold and myrrh they gave to you, and cried out, alleluia, 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 alleluia. You came to rescue me, this baby boy would grow to be a man and one day die for me and you. My sins would drive the nails in you, that rugged cross was my cross too. Still every breath you drew was hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah,
in the darkness we were waiting, without hope and without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. To reveal the kingdom coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died. And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. And the Church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel and shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Praise forever to the King of Kings.
You may be seated. You know, this is, if you follow the liturgy, this is what we call Baptism of the Lord Sunday. And to me, there is, when I think about baptism and I think about songs and I think about different things, there's one song that just, it stands out to me probably more than anything else when it comes to baptism and just kind of what a song means. Because this song, you know, it says people started talking just to hear their own voice. Those people tried to accuse my father, said he made the wrong choice. But it's called Washed by the Water. You know, and no matter what people think, us as Christians, what choices we make or how we want to live our lives, we know that we're washed by that water, and we know that God has our back. Daddy was a preacher, she was his wife, just trying to make the world a little better, you know, shine a light. People started talking just to hear their own voice. Those people tried to accuse my father, said he made the wrong choice. Though it might be painful, you know, time will always tell.
Those people have long since gone. My Father never fails. Even when the rain falls, even when the flood starts rising, even when the storm comes, I am washed by the water. Even when the rain falls, even when the flood starts rising, even when the storm comes, I am washed by the water.
Even when the earth crumbles under my feet, even when the ones I love, y'all, they turn around and crucify me, I won't ever, ever let you down. I won't fall, I won't fall, I won't fall as long as you're around me.
Even when the rain falls, even when the flood starts rising, even when the storm comes, I am washed by the water. Even when the rain falls, even when the flood starts rising, even when the storm comes, I am washed by the water.
I'm washed by the water.
Let us pray. God of power and majesty, you call forth creation. You act with strength and power. And so we praise you as we stand in awe of your glory. You are mighty and powerful, and yet you care for us, each so tenderly, pouring your spirit of love upon us and recreating us for your work in the world. We are so tired. The holidays were a wonderful and busy time as we celebrated the birth of Jesus Christ. And now as we return to life without the festive celebrations, we long to avoid the feelings of being let down or discouraged. Teach us, O God, to listen for your gentle voice. Help us awaken to the quiet stirrings of new life in our hearts and in our communities, as your children called into being by your word. Remake us, renew us, that we may follow you with joy. Send the power of your spirit among us, that we might become agents of your love and peace in a world of chaos and hate. And now we pray the prayer that your son taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. All right. If we have any children going to children's church, now would be the time for them to follow Miss Lauren. And this is also Connect and Refresh. It's an opportunity to greet those around you, especially those you do not know yet. Refill your cup or your plate, and when the band starts, you'll know it's time to return to your seats and continue with our service of worship. Connect and refresh.
Yeah, I kept trying to bump it down and I didn't change. I'm going to come up here and kind of like at least set it up like Tuesday just
right
because.
Up
I said, I'm going to probably come up here and at least kind of halfway set it up.
I knew it was.
Get it from my office in here.
Off center.
Yeah.
My dad was bragging on you in that song.
All right, let me.
I'm just glad I could hit that
let me
note.
See I know we got rehearsals Monday. I don't think we have anything Tuesday night.
Because I have to like flip like yes, my yeah. did a head voice.
I'm so excited. Well, that's the thing too. If you wanted to come up here at lunchtime and practice, we could.
Yeah,
I'll bring a guitar
workout.
And we can have a lunchtime jam.
Everybody work out.
As everyone starts to make their way back to their seats, you know, we are starting a new sermon series today called Unraveled. And part of the sermon title today is Sarah Laughs. Sometimes God gives us blessings that we fail to realize the true blessing in the situation. And that's what the song describes.
While the world looks upon me as I struggle along, they say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart I'm rejoicing, how I wish they could see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Well, I know I'm not wealthy, and these clothes, they're not new. I don't have much money, but Lord, I have you. And to me, that's all that matters. Though the world may not see, thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Now there's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
Of Mary. And as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day, he looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I have found favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourself under the tree. Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourself, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes. Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before the men, and he stood by them under the tree where they ate. They said to him, where is your wife Sarah? And he said, there, in the tent. Then one said, I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son. And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, after I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure? The Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh and say, shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old? Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son. But Sarah denied, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. He said, oh, yes, you did laugh. The Lord dealt with Sarah as he said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had promised. Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to his son, whom Sarah bore him. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Now Sarah said, God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me. And she said, and who would have ever said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son of his age. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
A soon-to-be bride has a vision of her father walking her down the aisle. A couple is planning a vacation, and one that they have carefully been saving for and preparing for, and they're so close, and the excitement builds. A parent anticipates their child getting the scholarship and going to their dream school. A couple dips into their savings to pay for something that they know will later be paid for and covered by the end of the year bonus that is certainly, certainly going to come. Dreams, goals, visions, all it takes is a second, a dreaded phone call, a diagnosis, corporate downsizing. When things can feel like they are unraveling and coming apart in life so soon after, when everything feels right and good and coming together. We don't want to hear about things unraveling in our lives. Unraveling normally has a negative connotation. Things are falling apart. But God is in control, and sometimes God unravels things for good. And sometimes God ravels and binds things for good, and we can't always tell the difference. I mean, think about things unraveling. If a rope unravels, something that could have tied and held things together can no longer effectively do that. But think about a knot coming unraveled, which is a good thing because things that had been locked in and kept from a future are all of a sudden free. And then there's most recently, maybe you experienced unraveling Christmas tree lights. That's like bringing order to total chaos. And so things are always raveling and unraveling. What we can do is we can put faith in God's promise that God has a good plan for our life, that there is indeed a bigger picture. And we see this in Sarah and Abraham in this scene out of Genesis, in their old age, being promised a son. Sarah is approaching 100. Abraham is 100. Abraham was the first faithful person to follow God and to be in covenant with God. God promised Abraham that he would father a nation of people. And when that didn't happen, and Abraham and Sarah took things into their own hands, their idea and their relationship with God as provider became unraveled when they took things into their own hands to try to make this promise happen in the time that they preferred. We don't have control over God's raveling or unraveling. We can't pick the time and we cannot pick the speed with which it will happen. In the waiting, Abraham and Sarah unraveled God's plan. They involved another woman, abused her, and took her for granted that she would be the one to father the promised son of Abraham. Deep into her old age, imagine Sarah, how humiliated she must have felt for so long for being infertile and incapable of having this promised son that God had told them about. Imagine the hurt. Imagine her feeling like God wasn't answering her prayers. We're talking a lifetime and more of her living with the disappointment despite God's promise. But then an angel comes and gives them good news. It reveals that she is pregnant. When this happens and Isaac is born, God unravels this image, this false idea of God as not being able to provide as God promised. God unravels the tangle that they had made of his image in growing impatient and taking things into their own hands. God unravels their knot of disbelief and unfaithfulness. God unravels our knots that lock up our capacity to believe in the impossible. You know, this may be a good time to talk about unraveling. This time immediately after Christmas is known as some of the worst time for anxiety and depression of any other time of year. Suicide rates go up. There are more deaths. It seems like there's more deaths at this time of year. It's when the dreaded phone calls come. And so it's a good time to talk about God's good plan for us. There's one thing that God will never unravel that we cannot touch or unravel, and that is God's plan for humanity, God's plan for you and for all of us. Peter Steinke wrote a book called How Your Church Family Works, and he borrows on science and psychology, and he talks about how there's the 15% of our brain that is unconscious and reactive. It creates instinctive reactions that protect us from threat. It's designed to protect us, and because of that part of the brain is reactive and is ignited immediately upon threat, it goes haywire. And it overtakes the part of our brains that are imaginative and responsible for diagnosis and problem solving. And so when we get these threats that come, the phone call, the layoffs, the diagnoses, the tragedies, that we cannot think and be creative and imaginative and faithful and believing in God's bigger picture. Steinke, he shares that anger and anxiety and anguish, they all share a common Latin root, which actually translates as choke. Bound up and knotted up to the point of not being able to breathe or to give pain by pushing together. And so we bind ourselves in knots of our own making, which is what Abraham and Sarah did. And they brought trouble on an innocent person, another woman that's not mentioned in this passage, but this is kind of what's going on under the surface and behind the scenes. But God wants to unravel the grip and the control that we try to have over our lives and the lives of others. God wants to undo those knots that are tightened by fear and anxiety and impatience and the need for control. And not just loosen the knots, but to unravel to joy and laughter. That after all of this, Sarah laughs, and maybe not in a good way, maybe out of her disbelief. But we know that by the end of this scene, she has immense joy because God's plan came to fruition at a time that they could not predict and in a way that they could not predict. God wants to untie us from our own self-destruction and tie us up with a shared purpose. That is to continue the mission of the church, the mission of God's people. Genesis 50, verse 20, it says, "What evil means for harm, God means for good." God produced something good out of the enslavement of the Israelites in Egypt in a way that they could not have predicted or timed. Revelation 21:5, it says that God says, "I am making all things new. I am tying and untying. I am unraveling and raveling for His good purpose." In Romans 8:28, one of my favorites, that God is working all things for good. All things for good. There can be joy in the unexpected, like there was for Sarah. The joy that comes after a long time of suffering and humiliation. God unravels. When we've been bound up by sin, God unravels to joy. for all of us. The sacrifice that Christ paid, the suffering and the death, that we could be set free from the knots that tie us in sin. The net that God uses to preserve your life will never come unraveled, will never come untied. This is the in the church calendar, as Lance said earlier, that this is the day that we remember Jesus' baptism. Jesus' baptism, we remember Jesus' baptism, we are called to remember our own baptism. That doesn't mean if remembering the actual event, but recalling and bringing back to our mind once again what God has done for us through sin to give us new life, to give us resurrection from sin, to bind us together with God, cords that cannot be broken. And so I encourage you to remember your baptism today, to think again about what it meant, the covenants that were made by your family and by your congregation and by God to claim you and give you His Spirit. And when Jesus was baptized in the Jordan by John, He didn't need to be baptized, for He was without sin. But He did it for us, to give us a model and an example. And the dove representing the Holy Spirit comes down and touches Him in the same way the Holy Spirit touches us. And we untie ourselves from sin because of the opportunity given to us through Jesus Christ. We experience joy and freedom. And today we get to come to the table once again and remember, recall what Jesus did for us. This is a table that Christ our Lord invites all of you. Anyone who is eager to repent and to know God is invited to this table. It is an open table. The presence of Jesus is here. We should come running and not ever feel like this table is unopen to you because of your denomination or what church you may go to. We call this an open table. It's not Central's table, the United Methodist Church's table. It is Christ's table. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. One more. There, like magic. God provides. Let us pray this prayer together. Covenant God, You made us Your people, gave Your Son as a pledge of Your love. It was by His blood that we were baptized in relationship with You. Yet we make trivial both His blood and the water, which symbolizes our entry into the church. We forget or neglect our covenant baptismal vows. Teach us to live like those who have accepted the obligation and the responsibilities of baptized believers. Forgive us our sins. Restore us to harmony with You, we pray. Hear the good news, dear friends. Jesus releases us from our burdens. You can place your whole trust in Him. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Before the mountains were brought forth, or you had even formed the earth, from everlasting to everlasting, you alone are God. You created light out of darkness, and you brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image, and you breathed into us the breath of life. And when we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and you spoke to us through the prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and we join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, God Almighty, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, in whom you have revealed yourself, our light and our salvation. In his baptism and in the table fellowship, he took his place with sinners. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and you made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, the night that everything from the perspective of everyone but Jesus seemed to be unraveling and falling apart, when Jesus was actually walking out God's plan, he had a meal with his best friends and disciples. And on that night, he took bread. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup from the table and he gave thanks to you, Father Almighty. And he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Another note of instruction, we have gluten-free bread in a dedicated cup. When you come forward, if you desire to take that, then just let your server know and we will get that for you. We also have a few of the pre-sealed communion elements, and those are available for you as well. We will come from the side and return through the center back to your seats. Can my servers, our servers, please come forward at this time? Come, the table is open.
Blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand ease our suffering, and all the while you hear each spoken need. You love us way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. We cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness. We doubt your love. As if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while you hear each desperate plea and long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? Friends betray us. What if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if my greatest disappointments or the aching of this life is a revealing of a greater thirst world can't satisfy? And what if trials of this life, the rain, the storms, the hardest nights, are your mercies in disguise?
Let us pray. We pray this together. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves to others. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand for benediction. Children of God, go forth knowing the good plan that God has for your life, and know that joy is coming. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, all God's people said, Amen. Yeah.